I will talk today about creative planning for a shrinking society. You have here the outline, the issues, the challenges, turning problems into assets. And then I will give you a wide example of wonderful, let's say, interesting projects, how to react to decline. And you probably would know that there are many such projects in Italy. So I will not talk about Italy because you know that better than I do. But I will present you some projects around the world on the issue of how to deal with decline. And I will end up with some very brief ideas about a normative way of slow planning instead of fast planning. Now, what are the issues, the challenges? Well, from the title, we have creativity and planning. But the question is, what is creativity? What is planning? What is urban planning? What is planning in general? What is creative planning? When is planning becoming a creative thing? So just to give you an idea what I have in mind when I talk about creativity and planning. Then the next big thing is the shrinking society. What are the reasons of shrinking? Shrinking population, shrinking economy, shrinking public sector. That's some of the things which we have to face, and especially, of course, these days, shrinking public budgets, whether we like it or not. And the third section is then now the reaction to shrinking, so how to cope with decline, how to turn problems into assets, planning for degrowth, a terrible word. Décroissance, the French word is much better, but somehow we say shrinking, we say, even in German, we use the word shrinking instead of slimming down, instead of schlanker werden. And then, as I said, I will talk about slow planning. Now, what is creativity? What is planning? What is creative planning? I start with recommending to you a very interesting book by an Italian sociologist from the University of Rome, Domenico De Masi, La Fantasia e la Concretezza. And he has given a big list of what creativity is. And it's very good to read, even for somebody who only understands every 20th word. And if you translate it, creativity is the goal, creativity gives meaning, creativity gives life. Creativity is a duty for engineers, I feel it is a duty. Creativity brings peace. Creativity is rebellious on the other side. Creativity is mysterious. Creativity is joyful. And creativity is impertinent and gentle. So it's a whole spectrum of definitions and ideas and thinking about what creativity is. One of the Bibles of those people who deal with creativity is this a book by Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. Though it's not so easy to talk about this, the Armenian guy who has wrote this book, but in English. And he says, creativity is any act, idea, or product that changes an existing domain or that transforms an existing domain into a new one. And the definition of a creative person is someone whose thoughts or actions change a domain or establish a new domain. And it is important to remember, however, that a domain cannot be changed without the explicit or implicit consent of a field responsible for it. So you have to read it several times to really understand the meaning. But he is a psychologist, and he is dealing with creativity from his disciplinary perspective. An economist, De Bono, another American economist, he says, well, creativity is a messy and confusing subject. And it seems to range from devising a new toothpaste cap to Beethoven's writing his fifth symphony. So creativity is everything. And as you know, I think that the most interesting dimension of this definition of creativity is that creativity is positive. You would never say creativity is negative. Yeah. So if you would say, oh, your child is creative, you don't say this is negative, you say it's very positive. So, and if you are in kindergarten, creativity is the objective of child education. You come to primary school, it's getting a little bit less. If you come to secondary school, creativity is cut. If you come to university, in most universities, there is no creativity anymore. Then you make your final master degree. And if you go to the public sector, you know where creativity is, not there. If you go to Fiat, then they send you, the first thing they do with you, if they want you to become a manager of Fiat, they send you to creativity courses. And that's very interesting. Siemens does it, Fiat does it, and all the big firms, then they ask actors to come. I know Ferrari does, they ask actors to come to some kind of educational training programs within the industry to make you creative, because from kindergarten you lost your creativity step by step until the final master degree. I have to say, being in Italy, this is not the case in Italy. This is just Germany and some other countries. In Italy, universities are very creative because you have to survive in these universities. So all the simple creative means bringing into being something that was not there before. So you have something new. Creating a mess is an example of creativity. So my wife always says, you are just creating messes, yeah, at home with all your books. But creativity is, so to say, something which we can identify quite well. We now have the notion that creative output should not be obvious or easy. There has to be something unique and rare about it. Exceptional craftsmanship would fit here. And of course, we always think about creativity when we think about the arts, but it's more than that. Now, planning is even more difficult. And what is planning? And of course, as urban planners or spatial planners, we have our own ideas, but planning is done everywhere. Planning is done in the countryside. A farmer is doing some planning for the winter. Industries are doing the planning. So, but for city planners, urban planning is caring for people in the city, I would say. So that is the major objective. Sometimes planners forget about that. And when they do this piano regulatore, they do it for their own biography, but not for the people. I think that urban planning is mainly caring for people in the city, whether it is for a new urban quarter where people live, or even if it is a campus, a technology park, even if you do a transportation system, you care for people moving from A to B. Much is routine, much is business as usual, much is following established regulation. Some is creative, unusual solutions, not legitimized. It's getting less and less, but we have to, in some way, many planners feel today, we have to reinvent that planning is just more than regulation. And now we have a problem these days, because in the past, from my training, and most planners have been trained to plan for growth, for more, for expanding the city, for building new infrastructure, new railways, new roads, and so on. It was always planning for more. But now we come into a situation where we have to plan for less. And some people say, oh, you cannot plan for less. And most planners are not prepared to plan for less. I'll give you an example. A few years ago, I organized a student studio, something like what you have here, for German and Chinese students. And the Chinese student, the German students came to Beijing, and in Beijing, then our colleagues from Beijing University, from Tsinghua University, they said, okay, we have to plan for the town expansion of Beijing. So they selected the site of Beijing where the students should plan for 250,000 more inhabitants in 2 weeks. That's the normal speed in China. So 250,000 planning for growth with all this infrastructure, schools, kindergartens, and so on. So then the Chinese students came to Germany, to the Ruhrgebiet. The Ruhrgebiet is a declining area. So, but we said, we had agreed in the beginning, we plan for the extension of the town. Now the Chinese students expected that we also plan for 250,000 in the Ruhr. And then we had to tell them, no, we have not 250,000 people more, we have 250,000 less. So what do we do? How do we plan? And the Chinese students were not really sure what they could do. But then the German students, they had to cooperate. Then they told them, okay, you have to improve the quality of life. You have to plan bicycle lanes, you have to plan little gardens, you have to plan all these little nice things. I heard you had yesterday, you had a similar presentation here. So in the end, the Chinese students learned how to be modest and not planning for growth, but planning for decline. And the German students, who were used to plan for decline during their whole studies, had suddenly to switch their mindsets to plan for growth. So, but when we say creative planning, what is creative planning? And I have here a list of things which I feel what creative planning is. It's more than land use planning, of course, more than zoning and land use control, more than urban design, more than urbanism, and more than praising the creative class. But to do that is not so easy, and you need courage as a planner. You have to allow decision-making processes beyond daily routine. You would not accept to say, oh, we have always done it that way, we do it in the future. You have to open, so to say, the participants in the planning process. The planning is done in a context where many actors, many stakeholders have an influence on what is being done, whether it is growth or decline. But you have to open these networks for non-established sectors. So outside of the mafia of local real estate agents and outside of the mafia of local politicians. So you have to ask groups of the civil society to come in. You have to ask local shop owners who normally are not participating in this planning process. So you have to open it. You have to open up the process. You have to learn from creative grassroots initiatives. You have to secure participation of the young. You have to initiate regional dialogues and fora for regional communication. You have to build partnerships, new partnerships. You have to set ambitious targets for regional economic circuits so that the money is not going to Guernsey and other Florida or wherever it is, that the money remains, so to say, in the region by creating regional circuits, buying regional products, form strategic alliances, promote catalytic projects for creative learning. You have to learn from projects where then all these people are participating and then somebody has a new idea. First everybody says, no, you can't do that. And then at some point maybe the process accepts a new idea and then starts a momentum to get more. Encourage the formation of international platforms. And I always say what we need in the end is foster creative banking. Now the economic crisis had a lot of creative banking, but not for the people, but just for their own pockets. And but to find money for local projects and get support of local banks is also important in this process of creating planning, because if you don't have the money, you cannot implement it. There are many reasons why planning, creative planning or creativity in planning does not work. So you have no visions. You have a group of stakeholders and board members who always say, why not? I remember in my region, whenever I made some new proposal for some kind of project in a city or region, then everybody knew why it would not work. Everybody had good arguments why it would not work. Not just money, but we have never done it. And so, and this, yeah, this is one of the biggest impediments of creativity in planning. If you have too much regulation, you just support the lawyers, but you don't create environments for the future. You prepare environments for the future. Anticipating obedience is one of these problems. You say, oh yeah, the government would never accept that, and these administrators would never accept that, so we cannot do it. You have regional tribalism and communityism. You have communities of practice, like the Chamber of Architects, which says, no, we have to do it that way. We don't want to have any innovation. They would never say we don't want to have any innovation, but they would just bring arguments why it could not be done. You have gridlock decision-making process. You have no think tanks in the region who are, so to say, have the duty to think about the future in a creative way. You have a lack of risk-taking bureaucrats. I always try, but I never succeeded, I have to tell you. I wanted always to find a Nobel Prize for the most creative bureaucrat, because I feel that bureaucrats should not be rewarded for doing the duty, but bureaucrats should be rewarded for allowing something within the system to be done, but that is very rare. And of course our media don't really help us, and I know you have your problems in Italy with the media, the media would not support new ideas. They would always say, no, it's not possible. Now, I said planning for growth, planning for decline. So planning for growth is what you see here on this picture. You have Dubai, you have the American dream of suburbia, you have Beijing, where an artist made this scenario of a big sculpture in the big city of Beijing. And Beijing is, as you see from this little map here, is growing and growing and growing and growing. Today it has 16 million inhabitants. Maybe next year it has 17. And the planners are now preparing for a big urban agglomeration of 50 million people in Greater Beijing, Tianjin, where the TGV then is a local metro system. So that is planning for growth. Germany is a shrinking society, and this is symbolized by this prefabricated social housing, which these kind of houses you find in Leipzig. 50% population decline since 1931. Halle, another German big city, from 1986, shortly before reunification, to 2008, 30%. There's an Italian example of a shrinking city, that's Genoa, one of the examples is Liverpool. The first example is Detroit in the US, where the population is declining. But population decline is not the only thing. It is the decline of the economy, it is the decline of the local consumption environment. And The shrinking society has six dimensions. It has a demographic dimension, fertility, aging. So people don't want to have more than two children. So fertility is decreasing, and we have the aging society. So that is the demographic dimension. We have the economic dimension, which is shrinking as a spatial implication of globalization in some parts of the world. New technologies, new logistics, new mobility, structural change, consumption patterns. So all that is the economic dimension of shrinking. We have the social dimension with growing social disparities. We are moving towards a world where you have two layers. The layer who is growing and it's an affluent layer, and you have a local, another layer, which is the layer of social decline, social disparities, marginalization. Migration is only one component of it. You have the spatial dimension, that's what we planners are dealing with, declining cities and regions in some parts of Europe, villages and landscapes, and not just Europe, you have it in Australia, you have it also in the United States, but only certain parts. So we have growing disparities within our regions. And you have a cultural dimension where traditions erode and values change. And you have a psychological dimension, the negative image of shrinking and decline. So decline is always considered something negative, shrinking is something negative. If you say slimming down, then it would be more positive. But this psychological dimension is already is also including influential in all the politics of dealing with decline. So the shrinking society in Europe, there are many reasons. As we have just heard, democratic decline is one of them, and you have this in Germany and especially in Japan. Japan is even more declining than Germany, and the Japanese society is not yet clear how to deal with it. We have the exploitation of resources. That is something which happened over the last 2,000 years, that some cities grew and some cities declined. You have environmental reasons. You have new transport modes, new technologies, which lead to shrinking in some parts of a country, of a region. You have the loss of economic functions, closing of production sites, Fiat is closing. If you close Volkswagen in Wolfsburg and produce all the cars in China, then Wolfsburg is also an extremely shrinking city at the moment, it's still alive. You have loss of markets, especially to China these days, or let's say Asia. Declining productivity and competitiveness, lack of innovation. Somebody told me recently, what is the difference between Italy and Germany? He says, you have one guy to produce something, and in Italy we have always two. I think he was exaggerating. In East Germany we always said we have three. One was doing the work, the other one was sick, and the third one was organizing some material for his private home. But they three had one job, so that's why the productivity was very low. All these are, so to say, prejudice, but the lack of innovation, of course, is a serious aspect, a serious dimension of decline. Change of consumption preferences. Yeah, if you change from skiing to surfing and from skiing to cycling, then some regions may suffer from that. Loss of political functions, the relocation of a capital, wars and borders. When Germany was reunified, then the capital of Germany was translocated from Bonn to Berlin, or at least say half of it was translocated. And everybody said, now this is a big problem for Bonn, but somehow Bonn was very creative And it has not been a problem for Bonn these days, it is rather a problem for Berlin. So unemployment in Berlin is much higher than unemployment in Bonn, for example. Accidents like Chernobyl, nobody wants to go to Chernobyl anymore, and the same is true in Japan now in this region, which has had the experience of the tsunami. Out-migration, loss of tacit knowledge, end of external transfers and subsidies. Some Olympic cities had problems afterwards. Athens is one pertinent example of that. Germany had big programs for the border between East and West Germany. This was the Cold War subsidy, and then all these regions got a lot of money to develop the infrastructure. And then Germany was reunified, and suddenly this whole region did not get the money anymore. So they had experienced considerable decline. And climate change. And all these things have quite different local impacts on the labor market and on the quality of life. Look, for example, Germany. At the moment, everybody says it has a successful economy, but if you look at this map, you see all these blue areas are shrinking in Germany. Only Berlin and the suburbs of Berlin are growing, but in the rest of East Germany, even including cities like Halle, Leipzig, Dresden, you have only very small parts which are still economically at least stagnating, not if not growing. But the rest of East Germany is losing population, losing jobs, losing population. This goes hand in hand. And in some areas, in some of these blue areas, you have today high unemployment up to 25%, something which you only have in Italy and Spain and Greece, but also in Germany you have it. While Munich, Stuttgart, Frankfurt are growing like hell, property prices are going up. In Berlin, property prices stagnate. And one of the most successful areas of Germany in the Ruhr, which is the area around Düsseldorf, Cologne, is also suffering from enormous structural change and decline. How to react to shrinking and sinking? How to react to that? It's how to cope with structural change, how to find new uses for juridic structures, then this issue of turning problems into assets, planning for décroissance, and slow planning. So I make a little journey around Europe, showing how things have, where creative intervention, creative planning, has led to some very interesting dimensions of urban development. Here you see a former coal mine. It used to be the biggest coal mine in Germany, was closed in 1985 in the city of Essen, one of the cities losing a lot of population because of that. And this coal mine has been transformed into a mixed land use development, mixing creativity, creative industries, cultural facilities, educational facilities, in the context of what is called the International Building Exhibition Enterprise. It was not really a building exhibition, but it was a 10-year project to stop the structural change, or to use, so to say, structures in this region from coal mining, from steel production, which were not used anymore, into other uses. Now, transforming a coal mine into a kind of a creative quarter sounded very strange to the people in the beginning, and the industry was totally against this kind of project, but now it is relatively successful. When Kohlhaas rebuilt this structure, which you see here, into a museum of history, but it was not just public sector money, it's also private sector money, and the whole area has become a very interesting area and a UNESCO heritage. I remember last year I was invited by the city of in the suburb of Milano, Sesto San Giovanni, and they wanted also to become a UNESCO heritage with their old industrial center. So this has been quite successful, and it's worthwhile to see. Another very successful project of the same initiative was the harbor, the old harbor of Duisburg, where it was absolutely derelict in 1985, when a project started, and today it is the big entertainment area with cultural facilities, museums, offices, successful housing. They even built new canals there. So the whole area, a little bit like the Docklands, but in a totally different scale, was rebuilt, and it has become a kind of a very lively public space. In summer, it's full of people, and they even used some of the buildings, like this one where you have the two trees on top. This was an Israeli sculpture who used some of these old buildings as huge sculptures. Herzog Demeron, the Swiss architectural office, built a new museum of modern art on top of an old grain storage. So the whole area has become a new environment and gave hope to the city, which is one of the cities really suffering from decline. And here at the edge of, it's on the River Rhine, and in between the Ruhr and Düsseldorf and Cologne, has become a successful location. Another interesting project not far from this harbor is an old steelwork in Duisburg, which was partly dismantled. One of these furnaces was exported to India. The rest stayed here as a huge sculpture, and the huge sculpture has been used by a British light designer of the Rolling Stones to have a 2 hour light installation. And when you come on the motorway from Amsterdam to Düsseldorf, then you see on a Friday evening, you see this. And again, this area has become an entertainment area. This is in the center of a huge park, not a Disney park, but a public park, where all kinds of events take place, including weddings, including theater, including mountain climbing, and you can climb up this structures. And they used the unemployed steel workers who were working there to help to make this structure safe for visitors. So also they used also the unemployed here in order to transform this area into a creative space in Duisburg. And here you see that this is the whole area. And for example, there is another very interesting piece. You see a round dot on this map, which used to be a gasometer, a gas tank of this steelwork. This gas tank has been filled with water and is now the training ground for the local fire police for saving people who fell with their cars into the River Rhine. So they could not use the River Rhine as a training ground, but they used this gasometer as a training ground for saving people. So these kind of things. All this was possible because, I have to say, this building exhibition, Emscher Park, had a very creative leader, Karl Ganser. He was very imaginative and very powerful. He was really pushing through all these ideas, accepting new ideas, and everybody always said, oh, he is crazy. But now the whole region benefits from his craziness. Now, and this tells you that it makes sense to think about how to turn a problem into an asset. So, I think the first thing is, if you have a problem, then think about how could the problem be turned into an asset. I give you just one example, apart from those I will show you later on, or I showed you already, is if you have an area where you have a lot of air pollution, and then you start a program to solve this air pollution problem. In the Ruhr, I never saw a blue sky when I arrived there. And later on, of course, the blue sky is here again. And together with this blue sky, because of a lot of innovative economic development policies, now there is an industry of small and medium-sized firms who know how to turn bad air into good air, how to turn polluted water into clear water. So all these problems of this industrial area were the target of special innovative programs for local economic development, for startup, for new industries who got subsidies in the beginning, and now the industries are exporting industries, exporting the knowledge to China, exporting the knowledge to Latin America and other parts, because they know how to clean up the environment. So that is just one example. All over, and I know that there are many such examples in Italy, is the how old buildings can be used again for new uses, whether they are in the big cities or in the rural areas. Such projects require, as we can imagine, imagination, creativity. They also require passion and much personal institutional engagement and obviously some financial investment. One example, again, an old brewery in Dortmund has been turned into a cultural center with a center for media art, a campus outlet of the universities, a European center for creative economy, a center for cultural education, all this in an old brewery, transformed by a local architect into a kind of a new flagship project for the city of Dortmund. Another project in Dortmund is this one, it's an old steelwork in the south of Dortmund, 200 hectares. It was closed and then it was sold to a Chinese entrepreneur, a private Chinese entrepreneur. He sent 1,000 Chinese workers to Dortmund and they stayed there for a year to dismantle the steelwork, put little white numbers on each piece of the steelwork, and then they transported the steelwork by the Siberian railway to China near Shagang. And near Shanghai, in Shagang. And in Shagang, they rebuilt the steelwork. And I remember when I went there 2 years ago, I thought I'm back in Dortmund, because on the left side you see the old steelwork, and on the right side you see the new steelwork in Shanghai. So, and this is very successful. The guy, a private entrepreneur, produces now steel for Volkswagen in China. But what happened at this location? I think that is also an interesting case. At this location, you see today a big lake. And this big lake is where the steelwork used to be. And around this lake, you have middle-income housing. And this old mining community, which was totally derelict, high unemployment, is now a middle-class suburb. And instead of the steelwork, you have the lake, and it's on the other side of the lake you have a technology park which is linked to the university. So the whole idea of turning a problem, what to do with an old steelwork, into an asset is perfectly documented by this case. And they used the soil from the lake to build a new mountain. So you have a landscape which you didn't have before, and of course everybody would say, oh, you could have done it better with the architecture, it's not so perfect and so on, but the project has been implemented and it has been successful politically, economically, and socially. Another project in this in the world is this venture renaturalization. You see on this picture on the right side, you see an open sewer. For some reason, there was no sewage pipes, but the sewage, all the stinking sewage was in the sewage. So of course you can imagine that the image of this part of the region was not quite good. And then it has been started to renaturalize this river Encher, and you see on the right side how it looks today. And that is an 80-kilometer river, which used to be totally a backside, an industrial river, is now step by step in a 25-year project being turned into a natural river, its natural habitat, and so on. And the river has been nominated to be the German River of the Year 2010, not the Danube, not the Rhine, but this open sewer. In East Germany, you have other problems. In the near the city of Cottbus, there was lignite mining, open cast lignite mining. And again, in the context of one of these very interesting, I think, German policy instruments, International Building Exhibition, they started a 6 years project to turn this industrial landscape into a kind of a slow tourism region. So this is not a region where tourists went. But now, after 6 years of very careful intervention into the landscape, and the old lignite mines were flooded, and you have a landscape of lakes, with second homes, with little weekend activities for kids, or mainly for families, and this whole region, which was a totally demolished landscape, is becoming gradually, again, an interesting landscape, 80 kilometers away from Berlin, 80 kilometers away from Leipzig. So it is a place where people spend, make weekend excursions with their families. And it looks like this today. So a whole an artificial landscape, yes, but artificially redone as a recreational area. And all this in the context of this event, IVA C. And the third example of this is another IVA in one of the states in Saxony-Anhalt, which is the state where in East Germany, south of Berlin or southwest of Berlin, where not really much happens. And the biggest city is Magdeburg, which is a city nobody knows, probably outside of Germany. And the whole area is really declining. People were migrating out. Many houses became empty. And they started an initiative with 19 local governments in this area. And each local government had, with very little money, not big European money, very little local money, and a little bit of state support, they tried to develop things like, you have here one picture. You have houses and then you have empty plots. So what you do with empty plots, and in this city they decided that they use these empty plots to give it to artists and ask artists to do certain things. In another city they asked the people in the street to buy an old house which was demolished together as a group, as a cooperative, and do something with it, and supported the group, the local community, and they created hope. And this whole initiative was about creating hope in shrinking cities, in derelict environments, and of course, the media reported a lot about this, and well, people started to appreciate what's happening. And just last week, I read that now in 2012, that's what we have, in 2012, now the number of people coming from West Germany going to East Germany for the first time since reunification is growing. And there are more people coming now from West Germany to East Germany than it used to be during the last 22 years. So it seems that there is hope. There is hope because all over there are initiatives, not this much money, not European funds, 500 million or whatever, building new infrastructure, building new things, but very local, very small-scale projects which improve the quality of life for the people who stayed there, and then they start attracting others, and even young people who went out after reunification because they didn't find a job there and went to Munich and Stuttgart seem to think about coming back. One of the very amazing projects, not far from Berlin, is this one. It's a tropical island. And you see that is an totally artificial island. It used to be a production hall, was planned to be a production hall for cargo lifters, for zeppelins. There was a guy, and he was very successful in getting money to build this hall because he said, I can move cargoes with zeppelins. I don't need streets anymore. I don't need tracks anymore. So, and then he said, I need a big hall. And he got the money for the hall. And, but briefly before he started, the whole thing collapsed. So he didn't get the market. They didn't trust him. They thought, okay, if this zeppelin, what's happening with the zeppelin? You all know the story of the Hindenburg zeppelin in New York. So there is some negative image with zeppelins, and he could not, all the engineers said it's okay and it's safe and so on, but he could not get into the market. So the structure was there. Then they started to think about what to do with the structure, and they wanted to demolish it. Then a guy from Malaysia, from Kuala Lumpur, came and said, okay, I'll buy this structure. He got it for almost nothing. And then I buy a tropical island. And people said, he's crazy. Yeah. Who wants to go to a tropical island in Berlin? And I could not believe. I was also among them who said, no, this is a crazy idea. But he risked his money, and now it is a successful holiday resort for Berliners who don't want to go to Greece anymore, who don't want to Catania anymore, who don't want to go to Florida anymore. But they go there for a whole day, pay quite a lot, go with the families there. Young people have their night parties there. You can camp in this hall. And has created, I think, 250 jobs there for the local gardeners and whoever. And it's quite successful, and only recently he has announced that they will build a whole town around this resort because there is so much demand for going there that he thinks he can make even more money by building a tourist village like the ones you have around here in Sestriere, around this place. So this is an attractive place for many Berliners to sit in the sun like crocodiles and enjoy, so to say, aperitivo. I showed you this picture in the very beginning about this derelict housing project in East Germany. You find it all over. And in the city of Templin, just as one example, they are transforming now these old structures into new structures, using the old structure, which you see on top, and you see the new house on the bottom, and then the third picture shows one part is still the old one, and the second part is the new one, and this has become very attractive housing for affordable housing, so it's not so expensive. You can rent 450 euros for 80 square meter apartment, which is fully equipped, fully modernized, high tech, energy saving, and so on. So the old structure was used, and with clever, creative architecture and engineering, it was turned into an attractive social housing project. This is the usual thing you find all over the world, old industrial structures turned into new lofts, industries, creative industries. One of the very successful ones is this old textile spinnerei. It's a little bit like you find in the Milano region, and has become a center for art and galleries and lofts and cultural life in the city of Leipzig. This is another example of creative capitalism. You would not know what this is. It looks like a normal castle, which is normally turned into a museum. But if you have no money for a museum, what are you doing? Here the city of Braunschweig asked the developer to come, and he made it a shopping center. So instead of building a shopping center out of town, the developer, real estate agent, came to the city center of Braunschweig and turned this Schloss into a modern shopping center where you have Armani and Gucci and all these things. Of course, you can imagine the architects, the superintendencia, were totally against it, yeah, because they said, how can you spoil this structure? But I think this has been quite done now, and this is very successful. And the developer, the real estate agent, or this ECE company, they have realized that shopping centers in the city center are much more attractive than shopping centers outside. So it's contributing to urban renaissance, to re-urbanization. People can walk there, and they can do their window shopping, and the all these chain shops are there, and of course they like it. A very controversial project turning an old structure into new use is this Philharmonie in Hamburg, where you have an old storage facility in the entrance of Hamburg, a very wonderful location. So all the ships, when they come from down the river Elbe, then they have to pass this place, and then a developer said, why don't we build the Philharmonic Hall there? And still not finished, will be finished in 2015 because it's getting more and more expensive. They started with 30 million euros, now they have 150 million, but in the end it will be 250 million when it is finished. But it will be the location for the new, a new cultural location in the city of Hamburg, the Philharmonie in Hamburg, Elbphilharmonie. Something what you could probably not do in Italy, and we could not do it in Germany either, but in the Netherlands you can do it. You can turn churches into something else. The most wonderful bookshop in Maastricht, in the Netherlands, is in a church. Yeah, so it's wonderful. You could spend the whole day, and if you like, that's where the altar is. You have a coffee shop. You can have your cappuccino and Campari and whatever, and you can read books. So a wonderful atmosphere. The success of this bookshop has inspired another entrepreneur in the city to turn another church, which was empty, into a hotel. So we have a hotel lobby, and so all this is in one of these old churches. In Germany, it would not work because our church would not accept that. They would say, no, church is church, you can make a museum, but not something commercial. So the cultures are really very different. I think in Britain you could do it. Yeah? In Britain you could even do sex shops in churches, but you could not do it in Italy and in Germany. Even the city of Zurich turned a whole industrial quarter into a cultural quarter, the city west. I don't go into any details, very successful because of its location near the city center. Beijing turned an old military factory, which was built by German engineers in 1950 for defense industry, into a cultural district. Now it has become a kind of an entertainment district for Beijing. First, the government was, was really attacking the people there. They did not want to have that. But now even the city has accepted that 798, that is the name of this district, has become a weekend resort for the young Beijingers, where they can walk around, can do shopping, can buy design products, can buy all kinds of things. There are all international galleries are represented there. And the artists who started there, and that is a problem of many such projects you find all around Europe, is first the artists are there, and once this area is successful, the first who have to leave are the artists. So some people said, whenever you have a derelict space, ask artists to use it, give it free to them. And then the artists within 5 or 10 years will raise the value of this place, and then you can, after 5, 10 years, you can harvest, and then the site has become a very attractive site. You find that in Berlin, you find that in Paris, you find that all over. And one good example is also this one in Beijing, which has been so successful that a private developer has now started at another location in Beijing to build a technology park for artists. So, totally modern. Nothing was there, not an old village. He calls it Art Village, but the Art Village for me was a technology park. And in this technology park, there are already now 5,000 artists working and living in a totally artificial environment, but inspired by those artists who wanted to have their studios there. They could not stay because it became too expensive, so they went to other places. And soon this other place will also be left by the artists and they move. So artists are the migrants of the city. A high-tech project around a derelict porcelain factory happened in Helsinki, Arabianranta. It is one of the very attractive now, very attractive housing environments in Helsinki, but it used to be a rundown industrial quarter of the city. And these kind of things you find very often in the United States, but you also find it in Europe. This was a former gold mine town in Australia called Valhalla, for very strange reasons. There was a Norwegian guy, and he came there and he started to build up the village. And of course, gold mining is over. So what happens to a village like that? And then some private civic action groups started, not the governments, started to make use of this village and have it a kind of a weekend target for families from Melbourne to go there. It takes you 1.5 hours to go there. And they made this old mining town a kind of a weekend resort for visitors from the Melbourne region. And another example, I don't know whether you have similar things in Italy. In Belgium, one village, again, declining village, rural village, turned the village into a kind of a bookshop. And they have 10 bookshops there, and on the weekend people are coming and are reading and drinking coffee and having decent food. So, and you have many other such book villages, one in East Germany and others elsewhere in France and so on. What is important in all of that is that you consider that the territorial capital, that is something the EU, that the OECD has pointed, that the territorial capital is important for doing something creative. So if you have to root something it does not make sense to transfer an idea from one place to another. It will, in most cases, it will fail. But the territorial capital, so what is there on this site, is extremely important. What is distinct from other areas? It is the geographical location, of course. It's the factor of production endowment, it's climate, traditions, natural resources, all that what we know. But it is also important that this what I call, or what the OECD has called, untraded interdependencies, such as understandings, customs, informal rules that enable economic actors to work together under conditions of uncertainty, or the solidarity, the mutual assistance, and co-opting of ideas that develop in small and medium-sized enterprises working in the same sector, social capital. And then there is something intangible, something in the air, called the environment, or in each language it has a different meaning, which is the outcome of a combination of institutions, rules, practices, producers, researchers, policymakers, that make a certain creativity and innovation possible. This territorial capital generates a higher return for certain kinds of investment than for others, since they are better suited to the area and use its assets and potential more effectively. So that is important, the territorial capital as the starting point for developing new things, creative ideas. Now, I will not go into any details. I will just say that there is a lot of literature now coming up more and more about sustainable capitalism, about alternative economic development, about new forms of post-industrial labor, about alternative social contracts and the welfare system. And they will promote local and regional economies, not global economies, local and regional economies, regional economic circuits, material exchange systems, and so on. So you'll find that in all languages. One is Tim Jackson's Prosperity Without Growth, so he tells you how a society can grow without growth, and can prosper without growth. And it was a report delivered to the UK government in 2009. I feel that the present government has not really read it. It's in the bookshelves of the universities, but not in the bookshelves of the government advisors. I like it very much. It's an Italian project the projet local, or the progetto locale, a new municipal towards self-government, which was came up from a professor at the University of Florence. You may know him, Alberto Magnani. It's worthwhile to read because it proposes a new charter for a new municipium where you balance between globalization and local development with new forms of direct democracy, new multicultural territories, new local self-sustainable economic systems. So the ideas are then again and again the same: local, territorial capital, people at the local level. So the Americans would say, oh yeah, it's very romantic, it's very old Europe, but maybe the old Europe is the new Europe. And a movement I don't need to present here in detail is the slow city movement, gaining momentum, more and more people are at least studying. At the moment, the slow city movement is developing a new charter, and just last month our German government has commissioned a study. What can we learn from the slow city movement in Italy for Germany? And also Italy has 80 slow cities, Germany at the moment has only 5. even there's even one in Australia and one in the US. So then the literature about degrowth, decline, shrinking is getting momentum, getting more attention, and so it has to do with all these movements which you find attack and so on, who say, look, we cannot go on like we do, we have to find a different a way for the future. And I will come to the end by saying that what we have to do is, at least in Europe, we have to think about slow planning, which would then be a normative approach, of course, to slow down the society, not just a reaction. There is a declining economy, what can we do? But also a more proactive normative approach to slow planning, to reduce speed, to promote slowness, to balance market economy and public sector responsibilities, to develop intelligent approaches to move people and goods, maybe with high tech, but also maybe with low tech, stop unnecessary mobility, and use new technology intelligent services for doing that. You had something about this idea yesterday, but maybe probably in a different way, using high tech for the new cities, I would say, using high tech to keep the old cities alive. Reduce energy consumption, prioritize regional food, regional economic circuits, encourage and give space for the civil society, revitalize and strengthen local crafts and locally embedded SMEs. I found a very interesting book, as much as I could read it, is Futuro Artigiano, about the role of crafts for the future of our society. We have lost it, but once this mass production goes to Asia, maybe we have to reinvent or revitalize the local crafts in Germany. So what, or in Europe, what we have to do, we have to discover slowness as in our life, to slow down and to improve the quality of life and the livability of cities. And I hope at some point, with all your projects, you can contribute to the discovery of slowness. Thank you very much for your attention.